In this set of mini lectures, we are going to be talking about oscillations and waves and sound. We're going to spend just a little bit talking about simple harmonic motion before we finally get to sound. You are doing some simple harmonic motion in lab, but I just want to talk about it here a little bit because some of the same principles with simple harmonic motion also go along when we talk about waves and sound and eventually light next semester. So simple harmonic motion is an example of cyclic repetitive motion. Something called a restoring force either pushes or pulls the object back toward its equilibrium position. And when some object is displaced from equilibrium in simple harmonic motion, the object continues to oscillate back and forth over the same path. And what we call the restoring force is always directed toward the equilibrium point. So here we have an example of simple harmonic motion. We have a mass attached to a spring. When you put the mass on there and just let it hang and let it go, if it's not oscillating up and down, then that mass is in equilibrium. But when you displace that mass from its equilibrium positions, we take that mass and pull it down and let it go, it's going to oscillate up and down, and it's going to execute simple harmonic motion. So what's happening here is that our mass is oscillating up and down, and there's a little piece of paper here that's being coiled up, and so this paper is running past this mass. Let's imagine maybe the mass has an ink pen on it and it's tracing out a path and this piece of paper is moving. So as this mass oscillates up and down over time, the mass is going to be displaced from some equilibrium position. The displacement is a quantity of distance, but it's also going to be executing these oscillations over some time period. And that pattern you can draw of the oscillation within time space looks like a sine wave. And when we're talking about simple harmonic motion, the amplitude is the maximum distance that that object has from its equilibrium position. So when we are pulling on the spring oscillates up and down, its amplitude is that maximum distance away from that place where that mass just hangs in equilibrium. Okay. And then we have something called the period. The period is the time it takes the object to move through one complete cycle of motion from maximum amplitude through minimum amplitude and back to maximum amplitude again. And then here's the plot of that mass's displacement on the vertical axis over time. Okay, so the period is the time it takes this object to move through one complete cycle. That's from maximum amplitude through minimum amplitude and back to maximum amplitude again. Now the frequency is the number of these complete cycles per unit time or vibrations per unit time. So there's a relationship between the frequency of oscillation and the period of oscillation. So the period is equal to 1 over the frequency, or the frequency is equal to 1 over the period of oscillation. You can always find the frequency of oscillation by seeing how many oscillations do you make over some time period? Okay, and usually that time period we want in seconds. So the unit of frequency is a unit that's 1/seconds, inverse seconds, and sometimes we just call it a hertz, H-E-R-T-Z, which we abbreviate as H-Z. Okay, now as our object is executing simple harmonic motion, it is going to have its greatest acceleration at its maximum displacement, okay? And it's gonna have its greatest velocity as the object passes through its equilibrium point. Well, maybe let's talk about this greatest acceleration and greatest velocity here with a different graphic. So here we have a spring oscillator. So it's a little bit different than what we did in lab where we had the spring hanging vertically. Now we have the spring on a frictionless surface horizontally. So in this case, for the spring oscillator, our restoring force is the spring force, and it's gonna be on a horizontal surface here. Let's take this first image A. Right here is the equilibrium position where the mass sits normally, and we're gonna pull that mass back away from x equals 0. We're gonna displace it some amplitude, and then we're gonna let it go. That spring force is gonna wanna pull that mass toward equilibrium. Now, as that object moves, its velocity is going to be greatest right here when it passes through the equilibrium point, okay? And this acceleration is going to be the greatest whenever it achieves its maximum amplitude. So here we're right at, moving through equilibrium. We achieve our maximum speed. And then when we achieve our maximum amplitude on the other side of equilibrium, that's when our object has its greatest acceleration as it's oscillating back and forth, back and forth. So the period of this oscillation is 2 pi times the square root of the mass divided by the spring constant in Newton over meter, okay? So the frequency would just be the inverse of this relationship. And then we have, so that's a simple harmonic oscillation when we use a spring oscillator. Then we can also do simple harmonic motion by using a simple pendulum. In this case, the restoring force is the component of the gravitational force, mass times gravity, tangent to the path of motion. So let's draw the free body diagram of our mass on the simple pendulum. So a simple pendulum is a mass attached to a string, and that string is attached to some immovable point. So we have our mass here attached to a string. We've displaced our mass from equilibrium, and we're going to let it go. So on this mass, we have two forces. We've got the tension force pulling upward, and we've got the mass times gravity downward. And it's this component here of the mass's weight that wants to be the restoring force to pull that mass back through equilibrium. So whenever we let this mass go, it starts up here. When it swings through its equilibrium position, it has its greatest speed. And when it comes over here to its greatest amplitude on the other side, it's going to have its greatest acceleration. It's changing direction, so that's why it's going to have an acceleration, greatest acceleration there. And then it's going to swing back through equilibrium. It's going to keep on doing this oscillation. The period of oscillation for a simple pendulum looks pretty similar to our spring oscillator. It's 2 pi, but now times the square root of L, where L is the length of your pendulum, divided by G, where G is the surface gravity, or the acceleration due to gravity. So here it's 9.8 meters per second squared, but if you go to a different planet, a moon, an asteroid, the sun, G is going to change, and so then your frequency or period of oscillation for a simple pendulum will also change. And remember again that the frequency of oscillation would be the inverse of the period. Remember, we can represent the oscillation of these simple pendulum, a simple harmonic oscillator, by a graph where we look at the position of that object over some time period. And that graph looks like a wave. Okay, it's executing simple harmonic motion, but that graph also looks like a wave. It looks like a sine function. So we can relate simple harmonic motion to waves. Here we have a wave, and we see that the shape of this wave, this is a wave that's a disturbance on the surface of water, the shape of the wave looks exactly like a sine wave. It looks like the simple harmonic oscillators we were looking at earlier, the graph of their displacement or their amplitude as a function of time. So that's what we're seeing here. Similar idea. And we can use similar quantities to describe that. In this case, for this wave that's moving across the surface of water, we can quantify what we call the wavelength. The wavelength is the distance between consecutive maximum amplitudes of the wave. So the distance between the peak of the wave and the next peak of the wave, that's the wavelength. Or you can count it from the troughs as well. And this is a unit of distance. The wavelength is represented by the Greek letter lambda. Here, that's what this fancy shape is here, the Greek lowercase letter lambda. Now this wave is going to propagate or travel along the surface of water. Now this wave is going to travel or propagate along the surface of the water. And waves carry energy. The energy in a wave propagates or moves in the direction the wave is traveling, but the components of the wave don't. Okay, so the little particles of the surface of the water are not moving forward in this case. They are oscillating up and down. Okay, they're oscillating up and down, but this wave form, this wave shape, has a speed, and that speed is forward in the direction to the right here on our screen. So let's say if we choose this point right here, the water molecules right here on this point of the wave are gonna move up and down, okay? They're gonna move up and down. But this shape of the wave has some energy with it, and this shape of the wave is gonna travel forward with some speed. And as this wave travels forward, it carries some energy with it. And the speed is related to the wavelength and the frequency of the wave. So the frequency is the number of oscillations per time that this little like water molecule would feel as it's oscillating up and down, as this wave is moving forward on the surface of the water. The speed of our wave is equal to the wavelength times the frequency. Or you can rewrite this to say that the speed of the wave is equal to the wavelength divided by the period of the wave. Because remember, frequency is 1 over the period, so you can rewrite this frequency here as 1 over the period. So we can also think about this little duck here. I was talking about the particles in the wave oscillating up and down. Or you can also think about this little duck here. As this wave moves through, the little duck here is not going to move forward along the wave. The little duck is going to oscillate up and down as this wave passes along the surface. Okay, so that's this bit about how the components of the wave do not propagate forward, but the wave itself does move forward. Eventually, next semester, we're going to talk about light. In light, the velocity of this wave is the speed of light, 3 × 10⁸ meters per second. But here we're going to be talking about waves through materials. That wave that we were talking about on the surface of water, light waves as well, those are what we call transverse waves. Transverse waves propagate horizontally, as do the longitudinal waves, which we're going to talk about here in a minute. But with a transverse wave, displacement of that wave is in the vertical direction. So here we have a slinky, and if we oscillate the slinky up and down, we get a wave pattern that has some forward speed, okay? This is a transverse wave, and we also played with this in lab. Waves on a string behave in a similar way. They're transverse waves. Then we have longitudinal waves, which are sound waves. Longitudinal waves also propagate horizontally, so that means they're moving sort of in the X direction, but they are a displacement in the horizontal direction rather than the vertical direction. So here, in order to make a transverse wave, we have to wiggle the wave up and down. To make a longitudinal wave, you have to push the wave kind of forward and backward, okay? So here this person is moving their hand forward and backward, and they're sending out a longitudinal wave. A longitudinal wave consists of a compression of the material through which this wave is traveling, and what we call a rarefaction, a lessening of that compression of the wave. And so these compressions travel forward at some speed. That's the speed of the wave. And also they have a wavelength. The wavelength of these waves is finding the distance between the center of this compression and then the center of the next compression. So then, what is sound? Sound is the oscillatory movement of air. And sound can also travel through other materials like metal, like water, like air. Maybe you've been swimming in a pool and you can hear, when you're swimming in the pool, you can hear sounds, sometimes maybe even louder or better than you can in the air. And those are sound waves that are traveling through water. They're going to be traveling at a different speed than they travel through the air because of the medium. Now, the propagation of sound is due to atoms and molecules moving back and forth in the material through which those sound waves are moving. So for example, here we have a string. Someone plucks the string, okay? And the string disturbs the surrounding air. So as that string vibrates, it compresses the material in the air. You get material that's compressed, and then you get material that's less compressed, which we call a rarefaction, okay? And so then you get these waves that you set up in the material. So you have regions where the material is more compressed, and then you have regions of the material where it's less compressed, which we call the rarefaction, and then you have material that's more compressed again. And so if the vibration of the string has a constant frequency, then you can set up these sound waves that have a fixed frequency and a fixed wavelength. Then how does our ear hear the sound? Well, sound wave compressions and rarefactions travel up the ear canal and they force our eardrum to vibrate. Okay, so here we have the sound wave moving through air. We've got the compression regions here, and we've got the rarefaction regions, which are less compressed. And so you've got a fixed wavelength between the compressions. And so you've got these density waves, essentially, traveling through the air, and they are hitting your ear with a fixed frequency, with a fixed wavelength, okay? And then that kind of forces your eardrum to move, to vibrate, and that sends a signal to your brain. The wave velocity of sound in air, the speed of sound, is equal to its wavelength times its frequency. But the speed of sound is also dependent on the temperature of the medium. So you can also find the speed of sound in air by using this equation here, by taking 331 meters per second and multiplying it by the square root of the temperature of the medium divided by 273 Kelvin. So this temperature needs to be in Kelvin. So if you wanted to find the speed of sound in room temperature air, which is at about 24 degrees Celsius, you would have to use this equation. And here where it says T, you would say 24 plus 273 on the top of this, on the top of this equation here inside the square root in order to find the speed of sound. This simulation is going to demonstrate sound for us. This is another FET simulation. Now I have a speaker here, and watch what happens when I click play on the speaker. So the speaker has a membrane right here, and that membrane is vibrating back and forth with some frequency. It's creating a compression and rarefaction of the air, and that's creating a propagating sound wave, okay? So here we have, let's say in the white regions, that's where we have a compression of the air, and in the black regions, that's where we have a rarefaction of the air. You see that the sound wave is moving out in a spherical shell from the source. That's what's happening in all sources of sound waves. They're moving out in a spherical shell from the source. What I'm going to do is I'm going to bring in a plot right here of the pressure in the air along the center line away from the speaker. The pressure here you see is varying. It fluctuates. And the pressure in the air, if I stop it here, the pressure in the air has a maximum amplitude right at the center of these compressions of the sound wave. And it has a minimum of the amplitude right here in the rarefactions between the compressions and the sound wave. So the wavelength of my sound wave would be the distance between these consecutive peaks in my pressure versus position graph for the sound wave. Here we're thinking about sound as a wave, but let's also see what happens when we look at the particles in the air. And so you can see how the particles in the air are bunching up to create the compressions, and they're kind of spreading out to create the rarefactions in between the compressions. And these waves are propagating with some speed away from the source. That's the speed of sound. Now you can also play around with this, but when you increase the frequency of the wave, you actually decrease the wavelength. The frequency is inversely proportional to the wavelength. So when you increase the frequency of the wave, the distance between consecutive peaks in this graph of pressure versus position for the wave, that distance is going to get smaller. And whenever, and let's even check it out. So if I press pause here, we can bring in our ruler and see what is the distance between. We've got about a wavelength, let's call that 76 centimeters at the maximum frequency. As I decrease the frequency, I should find that my wavelength gets longer. Okay, so I decrease the frequency and I play this. And indeed, if I come back over here with my ruler and bring it in here, I see that now my wavelength is a little bit longer. So if you decrease the frequency, you increase the wavelength, and vice versa.